All right, so welcome to lecture 27 of quantum mechanics, part one. And we have been talking about the quantum harmonic oscillator. And what we have discussed so far is we have discussed the algebra of these operators, creation annihilation operators, and number operators, right? It's the algebra of a dagger and then, right? Now, so some of you might be a little bit confused when I use the word algebra, because when I say algebra, the thing that comes to mind is, well, something like this: x squared plus y squared equals z squared, right? But these relations that these operators obey, right? For instance, the commutation relation. This is also an equation like this, right? Only difference is that instead of numbers, we have operators. So this is also an algebraic relation. So that's why we refer to this, the set of relations between all these operators as an algebra. Okay. And what we found is that the ground state is a Gaussian. And it is the ground state is annihilated by the annihilation operator. Annihilated is a sort of a fancy word. Annihilated just means that you have a matrix. It acts on a vector and it gives you zero. Okay. Now, one thing that we still need to work out is that when we raise or lower these states, we have some proportionality questions. And so we want to work out what those proportionality questions are. Okay.
So, excuse me.
Yeah, go ahead.
I have a doubt on the raising operator.
Yes.
So we usually, when a dagger operator operates on a bra from left side, right? Bra from mm-hmm. right side, right? But here we are operating a dagger on.
There is no such restriction.
Okay.
No, no. See.
Okay.
A is an operator and A dagger is an operator. Just think of this as an operator A hat, some capital A, and just think of this as an operator capital B. Any operator can act on a state. It can act on the state from the left, or it can act on the state from the right. This is just like matrix multiplication from the left or matrix multiplication on the right.
Okay.
Right. And there's no like anything that distinguishes this just because it has a dagger. Okay. That doesn't mean anything. It doesn't make it any more special than this or different. You could always exchange these two. We could always exchange these two. We could call A dagger or annihilation operator, and A to be our creation operator. Okay. So this is a matter of convention this is not the case. There's nothing in the physics or the mathematics which says that this cannot be the case. It's a matter of convention. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So it's just a matrix. You just think of it as a matrix acting on a vector.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. And now there is this one issue that when we are working with these states in like the position representation or in the real line, then these states are infinite dimensional, right? Because if you look at an expansion of the state in this form, the basis, it contains an infinite number of vectors, right? There's a vector for each point of the real line in eigenstate. So this is an infinite dimensional vector. And so this is also an infinite dimensional matrix. So when working with infinite dimensional matrices and vectors, you have to be careful. But all of these basic aspects of matrix algebra, they apply. The sense in which a matrix can act on a vector, or the fact that a matrix can have an eigenvalue, or diagonalization of matrices, and so on and so forth. So it doesn't matter whether you are working with infinite dimensional or finite dimensional matrices. This is important to understand, okay? Okay. So now, right, we want to work out what are these normalization coefficients, okay? So let's take A dagger and act on psi n. Okay, now we saw in our previous lecture that using these commutation relations, right, you have these commutation relations, right, and we saw that using these commutation relations we can derive the fact that for instance A acting on psi of n gives me an eigenvector of the number operator with one whose eigenvalue is one less than what you started with, right? And the same thing you can do with the creation operator, right? So if you act on this with the number operator, you get a state whose eigenvalue is, so you get, this is your expression, right? So what this tells you is that A dagger psi of n is proportional to psi of n plus 1. Okay? But what is the proportionality constant? We have to work that out, right? So let's take this A dagger psi n, and let me call it phi. And let me take the inner product, the norm of phi. So the norm of phi is going to be equal to I'm going to write it like this. Okay. So here when I'm writing the bra vector, phi, right? I can write that as psi n A, right? Because the Hermitian adjoint of this will be equal to this expression. And then phi is this A dagger psi n, right? In fact, let's not worry about this expression in the middle because that might just confuse you. I'll leave that off. Okay, now, so this is a dagger, right? And now we can use the commutation relation between a dagger and n, right? This is equal to the identity. So this tells me that a dagger is equal to a dagger a plus 1, which is equal to the number operator plus the identity. So I can substitute that in the previous expression. What do I get? I get the norm of phi is equal to psi n number operator identity psi n, right? Okay. And what is this going to be? The number operator acting on psi of n will give you just the integer n. I'll put hats on these because otherwise it might get confusing. So you will get n, and then identity will just give you 1, n plus 1 times norm of psi n psi n, like that. Okay? So what this tells you is that a dagger psi of n, right, which is equal to phi, is equal to what? Root of n plus 1 psi n, right? Because when you take the inner product of both of these expressions with themselves, on the left you will get this, you know, the scalar, the norm of phi squared, and on the right you will get n plus 1 times the norm of psi n squared. Similarly, you can show that if you act on this state with a, you get a root n. Okay. Okay. Now we can use this fact to express all of our states in terms of the ground state, right? So I start from the ground state phi naught, psi naught, and I act on it with a dagger. What do I get? I get root of n plus 1, which is 0 plus 1, psi 1, right? So this I'll just write as psi 1. Then if I act on psi 1 with a dagger, I will get n plus 1. Now n is 1, so I'll get 2 psi 2, right? So this is root 2 psi 2. Now you can write psi 2, right? You can write psi 2 as 1 by root 2 a dagger psi 1. You can write a dagger psi 1 as 1 by root 2 1 by root 1 a dagger squared psi naught, right? Because what is psi 1? Psi 1 is a dagger times psi, right? So you will get another copy of a dagger, and you will get psi naught. So if you keep repeating this, what you will find is that you can write down the nth excited state in terms of the ground state by raising the ground state n times, and then you have to put a normalization factor of 1 by root n factorial, because you will get a factor of 1 here, a factor of 2, root 2 here, you will get a factor of root 3 from the next term, and so on and so forth. All right. And now, what else? Okay, so this is one expression. Let's see, copy. Okay. Now, let's talk about expectation values. How do we calculate expectation values? Now, I've given this to you as an exercise, right? That to calculate the expectation value of this Gaussian state, to find this normalization constant. So how would you calculate this expectation value? You would take you would do something like this, right? You would say, let me just put it here in the corner. You would say that expectation value of X is equal to psi naught X squared times X dx, right? This is how you would calculate this expectation value, right? Okay. But there is a simpler way to do it. What is that simpler way? The simpler way is the following. We know that these operators X and P can be written in terms of A and A dagger, right? So what is that relation? Okay, so we'll just work out what that relation is, starting with this expression, right? I mean, it's easy enough to do that. Okay. So we can take these two expressions, and we just have to add and multiply, right? Add and subtract. So if I add A plus A dagger, what will happen? I will get on the right hand side, I'll get root of m omega divided by 2 h bar times x hat, right? And if I subtract these two, a minus a dagger, what will I get? I'll get, and there's going to be a factor of 2 also here, sorry. So let me just put that here, 2. Here I will get 2i 2m h bar omega times p hat, right? So what is x hat? The operator x. The operator x is equal to root of h bar 2m omega times a dagger plus a, and the operator p hat is equal to root of m h bar omega by 2 times I. I can take this I over on the left hand side and divide and multiply by I, and I can write this as a dagger minus a times I. Okay, you can put this I in the denominator if you prefer, it doesn't matter. So now what we can do is we can ask what is the expectation value of x in the nth excited state. Okay. And so from now, I'll just refer to the nth excited state using this notation. I'll just write it as ket n instead of ket of psi n. So what is this quantity? This quantity, well, I can substitute this expression here, right? So I have some normalization, then n, then a dagger plus a times, right? Now, if I look at this expression, this has two terms. One term looks like this, n a dagger n. What will this do? Well, I can take a dagger and act on the ket n. If I act on the ket n, what will I get? I'll get root of n plus 1. N plus 1. So this is the inner product of the nth excited state and the n plus 1 excited state. And what is this going to be equal to? Can anybody tell me? What is the inner product of two eigenstates?
Zero.
Zero.
Similarly, we have one more term, which is n a n, which will give me root n minus 1. It will also be zero. So this tells me that the expectation value of x in the nth state, in any state, right, is zero. This will be true for all n, right? Whether the ground state or higher state. And this makes sense because, again, we have a potential that is symmetric. X, so our potential has a even parity, but our operator X has odd parity. So when you take even and odd parity, you get zero. Okay. Similarly, you can just see in exactly the same way. That expectation value of P in any of the states will also be zero. Right? For exactly the same reason. And that's fine. We expect that to be the case because what this tells us is that the particle is, you know, equally likely to be on either side. So if you take the average, you get zero. The origin, the value of the origin. But something interesting happens if you look at the expectation value of x square and the expectation value of p square, let's say. Right? What will happen now? So I won't worry about these normalization coefficients. I'll just ignore them for the time being, okay? So what is x square going to be? It's going to be a plus a dagger squared. Right, now I can write this as a square plus a dagger square plus a dagger plus a dagger a, right? And then if I take the expectation value of this operator in the nth state, right, what will I get? I'll get the expectation value of a square, the expectation value of a dagger squared, the expectation value of a dagger, and the expectation value of a dagger a. this term will again be zero, right? Why? Because a square acting on n will take it to n minus 2. So the inner product of n and n minus 2 will be zero. This will give me the inner product of n and n plus 2, that will be zero. This will give me the inner product of n minus 1 on the left and n plus 1 on the right, that will be zero. This is the only non-zero term, right? And this is the number operator. The number operator acting on n just gives me n, right? Which is equal to n. So the expectation value of x squared in the n state is just the number n. Multiplied by the square of this. So if I put this in, if I put it in properly, you know, x squared n is going to be equal to m omega over 2 h bar, right? Similarly, if you take the expectation value of p squared in the n state, what will happen? Well, exactly the same thing will happen when you take the square of this operator. You'll get a square, a dagger, and a dagger, a. All of those terms, the expectation values will give you zero, except for the number operator, which will give you n. Right? And then there'll be this factor. So you'll get root of 2 m h bar omega. Not root, there's no root because it will be squared times n. And this is 1/2. Okay. Suraj, did you have a question?
No, sir, I was out of the meter.
Okay. All right. So we have a very nice picture here of this harmonic oscillator in terms of this algebraic method. But it's important to understand the analytic method, right? So what is the analytic method? By the way, you guys have class at 9?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this part I'll explain only very briefly. The details you can find in the notes that I shared with you on Telegram. The details are the proper derivation of this requires you get a differential equation, which is known as Hermite's equation. And Hermite's equation you can solve. So I'm just going to write down the result, okay? So we have our Schrodinger equation. Right, it looks like this: minus h squared by 2m d by dx squared plus m omega squared by 2 x squared acting on psi of x is equal to e psi of x. Okay, this is just 1/2 kx squared. I've written it in terms of omega, that's all. Now you can multiply, do some multiplication and so on. And we introduce this quantity x naught, where x naught is equal to root of h bar m omega, and I might have gotten the order of this power. So please check, okay? Because I think it should be h bar by m omega instead of the other way around. So we get h bar by m omega, we call this x naught, and then we define a new variable, which is x by x naught. And this is dimensionless. In terms of this variable, the Schrodinger equation can be written as follows. Is equal to okay. So this is just the kinetic term. This is x square that gives you this wiggly e. I always forget what is the Greek letter. Is it chi or scri or zeta? What is it? I don't know. I'll just call it zeta. Or I'll, what is it? Anybody remembers what the name of this fellow is? I'll just call it E. Looks like an E, right? And this K is 2E by H bar omega. Okay. So now one can solve this using a power series method, right? There are different ways to do it. And I'm not going to go over that. My hope is that in mathematical physics part one, you are being taught how to solve such equations, such differential equations using power series and so on and so forth. So I will not explain that in detail over here, okay? I'll just write down the expression. So it's not, it's something that's, well, not so pretty. I mean, it's not so simple. So this is psi of n, right? What is this psi of n? Remember that this is just the nth state, right? This is just the nth excited state in the position representation, in the position basis, right? So if I take the nth excited state in the position basis, I can write it like this, right? Some coefficients times the position ket vector times dx. Thank you, Priya. Zeta, that's what I suspected. So if you take the inner product of n with x, what will you get? You will get this psi of n x, right? And you can see that it's fairly complicated. You have this Gaussian factor here, right? Square over here. And then you have this h of n x by x naught, sorry. Is equal to, what is this object? It can be evaluated in this way. It's the nth, you can write it as the nth derivative of e to the minus x squared. Okay. And these are known as Hermite polynomials. Okay. Hermite is, by the way, the same fellow after whom we have the term Hermitian. And these are going to be polynomials. You can see that because if I take e to the minus x squared, take the nth derivative, what will I get? I will get, each time I take the derivative, I'll get one factor of x squared. Then you take the derivative of that, you get a factor of x. So you get x times e to the minus x squared, you take the derivative of that. So each, you get higher and higher order terms. So let me just write down some of those terms. Again, I don't expect you to remember these, but it is important to know the general structure, the idea of how one gets this. Okay. Right. So these are one example of these are called special functions. Right. This is one example. These are one example of special functions. Other examples of special functions are Legendre polynomials, Laguerre polynomials, Bessel functions, Chebyshev polynomials, so on and so forth. Right. And I'll stop here for the day. Okay. So the point is that the algebraic method is much, much, much simpler than the analytic method. In the algebraic method, you can do all the calculations for all the quantities, the energy, the expectation values of any of the operators, so on and so forth. And the manipulations are much easier. You can see how simple they are. If I just want to calculate this x squared in the nth excited state, well, I just get one term and this is like a two line calculation. But now imagine that somebody was cruel enough to ask you to do the same calculation in the position basis. In the position basis, what would it be? In the position basis, you would have to calculate x squared as integral of x squared psi of nx squared dx, right? Which means you have to take this ugly looking object, right? Square it, multiply by x squared, take the integral. And if you don't know of a clever way to do this, you can easily spend your lifetime trying to figure out the answer, right? Because you have the Hermite polynomials. The Hermite polynomials, you can see, become more and more complicated. But here, it's just this, it's so simple. Okay. That's the beauty of Dirac's solution. Okay. Any questions? Questions? No questions? Okay, let's stop the recording.